We'll have combined in different E15 sessions, two different E15 groups. So there's a group on subsidies and there was a group on industrial policy. But we saw that some of the policy options which came out from industrial policy also were commonly reached by the subsidies group. And we thought of combining these two. And when we talk of subsidies and industrial policy in a world of global value chains, we start with a framework where the policy options are somewhat different from the regular kind of policy options. So the classic industrial policy has been one of closing markets and an infant industry objective trying to be achieved through policies which were then called industrial policies. So to distinguish between the system as it exists today and the kind of policies which experience have taught us are likely to be useful for similar kind of objectives, namely to enhance your capacities and grow new areas of competence, we call it new industrial policy. So that's the first point I want to make. Then on subsidies, we found that there are, and it'll be obvious to you, that different countries have different abilities to give subsidies. The richer ones can give subsidies more easily than the poorer ones. However, some of the aspects become very important in this context, especially because of the different abilities. One is the possibility of addressing market distortions. So the classic market restriction policies are different in that nature from subsidies, because subsidies can actually address market distortions also. And another one is you may give subsidies, but you need to increase the effectiveness of subsidies. So there's a lot of work on that area which is going on. And of course, when you have to generate new areas of expertise, etc., subsidies become very, very important in that context also. Basically, in this background, also the increasingly complex global trade policies landscape, the mega regionals coming up, in thousands of bilateral investment agreements coming up, the situation of a deadlock in WTO's Doha development round, and a view that the WTO itself, the agreement, causes constraints on achieving the objectives which are normally those which are the aim of industrial policy. So we took all these issues and we started looking at them in the initiatives. Subsidies, one went very deep into the area of subsidies itself. And the E15 was an initiative by ICTSD and WEF together, the World Economic Forum, together with each group having a partner institution. So we ended up with 16 partnering institutions in 2011 to bring together about 400 leading international trade policy experts all together, around 25 in each. And we organized over 80 interactive dialogues. The experts really looked at the world as it's likely to emerge in the next 10 years. And what are some of the key problems which policymakers, business, civil society, and regions, countries, the world itself is going to deal with? So they came up with identification of these concerns and policy options to try and address them. The policy options together will be released at the World Economic Forum's annual Davos meeting in January next year. However, the E15 experts are discussing key WTO-related policy options publicly for the first time at the Trade and Development Symposium. So you have the experts here. We discuss through the E15 sessions a variety of issues, including future priorities. So you have the ministerial meeting here of the WTO, which is dealing with current concerns. But we take that into account, but also see the world which is emerging. And issues such as local content requirements in extractive industries, finance for development, agriculture, fisheries, clean energy technologies, services and global value chains, digital economy, and much more. So that's the E15. You'll see a lot of detail on subsidies coming up through the experts here. But I just want to give you a flavor of what the industrial policy group came up with in terms of policy options. A lot of effort is needed both through coordination and collaboration of government and business, and even those which are knowledge centers. So one proposal is to establish regional centers of excellence, which will provide a platform for learning from success cases, dealing with concerns, and a collection of data, and improving effectiveness of policies. Then sector-based model PPP agreements, improving the effectiveness of industrial policies that focus on learning from lead firms in value chains. A lot of lead firms actually impose conditions on the rest of the value chain. So how can we learn from them to become more effective in our own market presence? Building capacity of small and medium enterprise sector to fulfill international and lead firm standards. There are some initiatives. In India, there is a model with five different steps. Wherever you are, you are taken to the international standard. There is an MOU between the Indian Quality Council and the African Standardization Organization for a similar initiative. So there are initiatives which are going onwards with learning from this influence also. Then also, is people talk about the constraints from WTO agreements. Our assessment was that in general, the constraints are not there. However, there are a few places where they do apply, and one needs to look at that. So some of those aspects also become relevant. Then the TPP, TTIP, all the mega regionals, they are essentially not inclusive by the definition. How can we come up with ways of making them more inclusive? Through conformity assessment, through rules of origin, various such ideas. And a framework for key principles to bring greater conformity in private standards, because they determine the market access conditions. So this is the background for industrial policy. I'm giving you a bit more of this because the subsidies experts are very much present on the podium. We begin with Bernard Hochman, professor and director of the Robert Schuman Center for Advanced Studies, European University Institute in Florence. Some of the questions which he will deal with is, what is the main rationale for government intervention in a world of highly fragmented production networks? Is there a case for specific intervention as opposed to purely horizontal policies? Bernard, you have the floor. Where's Bernard? Here.
Okay. It's kind of interesting that of the two groups, we have the subsidies overrepresented relative to industrial policy. I think that may be telling us something. You can reflect on that, Harsh. So let me just go through, essentially I'm going to go through the paper that I did for the group, which looks at this whole issue of subsidies and subsidies rules from the perspective of that we live in a world of supply chains, and what are the implications of the rules that we have in the WTO potentially on subsidies, given that we are in a landscape where we have a lot of this supply chain trade with products crossing borders many times and production essentially being international, with final consumption being in a market which is far away from the various countries that actually are part of the production process. So let me start with evidence on subsidies, right? And I'm sure Gary is going to come back to this as well. And this is one area in which we don't have a whole lot of good data, right? So one good source of data that we have post-2008 is the monitoring that's been done in terms of the trade policy responses by G20 countries. And one of the things that you find from the Global Trade Alert database, which is the one I used in the paper because it's more comprehensive than the one that is put together by the WTO, is that subsidies actually are quite prominent in terms of what governments are doing. Now, partly, of course, that's a function of the economic state of the world at the time. Lots of governments were supporting industries in terms of helping them deal with the demand shock that they were encouraging and encountering. But at the same time, it's symptomatic of the fact that this is a policy instrument that is there and that is very heavily used. So we biased the exercise against subsidies in the sense that we focused on what is the relative role of subsidies versus traditional trade policy types of measures, where we counted each individual European member state as one when the EU took a trade action. And of course, that's kind of multiplying some of these trade actions by 28 because the European Union is a common market. And what you get is that subsidies are around 14% of the total actions that were taken between 2008 or the end of 2008 and when we wrote the paper, which is about, I don't know, 9 months ago or so now. So 14% out of 22,000 measures is quite a few measures. And it's the third most frequently used instrument overall, with, as Harsha mentioned, a very strong bias towards rich countries, right? Because obviously subsidies impose a fiscal burden. You have to be able to afford that. So it's not surprising that high-income countries use this about three times more frequently as an instrument than low-income countries. The other thing that comes out of the data exercise is that it's not just subsidies, but subsidies are also sectorally kind of concentrated, right? And one of the things we find is that, on average, we find much greater use being made of subsidies in services sectors than in goods-producing sectors. And partly that's probably a result of the fact that tradable goods obviously can get stopped at the border, so trade policy works, whereas it doesn't really work very well for services. So again, but if we're thinking about what is the incidence of subsidies and how should we think about subsidies in the current world economy, I think this is a stylized fact to kind of keep in our heads, is that a lot of this is being done in services sectors, and services, of course, account for the major share of GDP. The other thing you get out of the Global Trade Alert database is that investment measures are also quite frequently used. And again, this is often not restrictive measures, but supportive measures, right? So measures that governments take in order to encourage foreign direct investment to come to their markets. And this is kind of a recurring theme in the sense that subsidies are a substitute for investment, because you want to, often what is the goal is not so much to protect or help a particular domestic firm, it's really all intended to attract investment into a particular location. So that is, as far as the stylized facts are concerned, is to say this is something that actually does matter. Now, what the paper then does is it goes through what are the arguments for using subsidies, right? So there are potentially efficiency reasons to use subsidies to offset market failures. And one of the, I think, things that we need to think about, and I should tell you up front that we certainly don't come to a clear conclusion on this, and I think it really is an area where much more work is needed, is to think about where are those market failures in a supply chain world, right? And mostly what the research literature in this area suggests is that the kind of traditional policy prescriptions or suggestions that are made in terms of improving the investment climate, in terms of ensuring competitive markets, all, you know, go through in a supply chain world as well. But one of the characteristics of supply chains or value chains is that quite frequently you're going to have some very particular bottlenecks. You're going to have very particular specific inputs that are needed in order to make those supply chains work. And those might be missing, right? So the market might not be delivering those particular inputs. So therefore that calls potentially for government intervention to address those types of market failures. And this is often going to be a coordination failure or information asymmetries. It can relate to policy uncertainty and so forth. So here FDI is very important, because quite frequently these value chains are going to be driven by lead firms that are either going to be establishing in the market, or it's going to revolve around attracting first tier suppliers to major lead firms. But it's very much an investment story. So part of the role of subsidies in practice is going to be to attract investment into not just your market, but to attract investment in terms of dealing with these particular kind of specific inputs that are needed to make a supply chain work. So then this gets you then into issues of definition, right? So what actually is then a subsidy? If we are supporting a particular investment in a particular type of activity, let's say the coal chain, or cold storage, you know, is that then going to be a subsidy or not? The stylized facts here, however, are that everybody's doing it, right? So there's a lot of this type of policies being applied across countries, not just developing countries, the same thing in industrialized countries, and a lot of it revolves again around attracting investment. So the big question then is, you know, are these policies then creating, one, are they addressing those specific market failures, which is a traditional question to ask with respect to subsidies and industrial policies more generally, and then secondly, are they creating externalities in terms of what happens in other markets and other firms? And I think here it becomes much more complicated to make that assessment because these value chains are going to cross many countries. So in a sense, what we're going to be talking about is not so much the old-fashioned view of trying to assess the impact of a subsidy and deal with a subsidy, because it's all about trying to attract or trying to support a particular activity in my country. But my activity is going to depend on the ability of the other suppliers in my supply chain in other countries to also produce goods and services competitively. So there's clearly a case for races to the bottom in terms of investment incentives and incentive competition between countries. But at the same time, if we're thinking about what are the welfare implications of the subsidies we see in that are specifically geared towards making supply chains work more efficiently or attracting investment to produce in supply chain, that becomes a lot more complicated. So what does that imply for rulemaking incentives and the implications for rulemaking? Well, what we argue in the paper is that it's not at all clear that it makes sense to limit attention to subsidies as currently defined in the Agreement on Subsidies and Countervailing Measures in the WTO, because there is this strong connection to what are essentially industrial policy motivations, which might actually make a lot of economic sense, but which will not necessarily take the form of fiscal contributions that are specific, and some of those fiscal contributions that are specific might actually make a lot of sense from an economic efficiency perspective. So yes, those things might also create spillovers, but we are in this discussion, which has been going on, of course, more generally, as to, you know, how do you trade off what the objectives are of a particular subsidy? Is it really dealing with a market failure or not? But the distributional effects of subsidies in a supply chain context are going to be much more complicated than was the case if we're thinking about, you know, what is sometimes called ship and forget type trade, where essentially we produce a product in a country, ship it to another country, and we're subsidizing that collection of activities in that particular market. So what that suggests is much more also a need to focus on competition policy types of questions, right? So again, that gets linked to the spillover issue, whether or not there are negative externalities associated with the pursuit of particular subsidies that are targeting specific supply chains. And, you know, that is, again, something which we don't have in the WTO at the moment, right? So again, that gets us back, in a sense, to the past. But clearly that is a focal point which I think would be much more useful to apply than the much more mechanical approach that is taken in the Subsidies Countervailing Measures Agreement, which is essentially just about what is the effect and not really asking about what is the intent and is this enhancing global welfare or not. Okay, so one final word on services again. One of the things that is clear from the data is that given that a lot of the subsidies are targeting services, and given that if you want to be competitive or attract investment to actually produce goods, that's going to require services inputs. If a lot of those services are being subsidized one way or another, then that also calls for thinking about whether or not you need rules for subsidies for services, which of course currently is not the case in the WTO. So in a sense, we're missing competition policy, we're missing the services dimension, we're missing a focus on investment incentives in the WTO. So in that sense, the main conclusion of the paper is that, you know, the current approach of trying to discipline the use of subsidies in the WTO is way too narrow, but at the same time, it's also not clear what the specific rules of the game should be, because there could be a very good economic rationale pre-intervening in terms of making these supply chains actually economically feasible, in terms of dealing with these coordination failures, market failures, information asymmetries, which are quite pervasive in this particular area. So the main conclusion then in the paper is we need to look much beyond subsidies narrowly defined, and we need to really start thinking much more seriously about where it makes sense for governments to intervene in terms of making supply chains work, but also to do much more work in terms of determining what are the negative spillover effects of what a government might do to attract a particular supply chain related activity in a particular location, which at the moment is a bit of a black box, right? So, and there isn't even much in the way of theory on this either that can guide us. So I think, unfortunately, the conclusion of the paper is we need a lot more research, which of course is something that academics get, you know, accused of quite frequently. But in this case, I think it's absolutely the case. We don't really have much theory, we don't have much data, and I think what we need to start with is the data, which is relatively more straightforward to collect, and then incentivize a whole bunch of graduate PhD students to start doing work on this. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Bernard. One thought, because I'd raised the question, is there a case for specific intervention as opposed to purely horizontal policies? One could think in two different ways about horizontal. One is horizontal subsidy, which is very general. In the subsidies agreement of WTO, there is a concept like that. One is subsidizing a sector or an activity with horizontal implications. And the two are very different concepts. In industrial policy, it's the latter, which has been seen to be very useful. Each speaker, about 8 to 10 minutes. Next one is Mark Wu, assistant professor at Harvard University. And he'll address what specific areas need additional policy space flexibility. Could a case be made to reintroduce a category of non-actionable subsidies to address objectives such as mitigating climate change and promoting innovation? Mark, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Harsha. So the question that I'm going to ask today concerns whether or not there is sufficient room given in the existing treaties concerning certain forms of subsidies that may be desirable to address market failures, positive externalities, and so forth that Bernard alluded to earlier. And this was an issue that was looked at both from the E15 subsidies group as well as from the E15 industrial policy group. But before I go into that detail, I realize not all of you have chosen the boring career of a trade lawyer that I have. And so not all of you may be well immersed in terms of the details of what the law actually provided for and how the law has changed. So let me just take a minute to quickly outline that. So the main agreement governing subsidies in the WTO regime is the SCM agreement. And as many of you know, the SCM agreement originally included in Article 8, which talked about non-actionable subsidies. These were subsidies that you could provide without fear that they would violate trade rules, and were commonly referred to as green light subsidies. There were three categories that fell underneath this: R&D subsidies, subsidies for disadvantaged regions, and subsidies for environmental adaptation. Now, this Article 8 non-actionable subsidies, green light subsidies, was provided for a five-year period to be reviewed at the end of this five-year period. At that end of that period, for a number of different reasons, which I won't go into right now, but needless to say, at the end of 1999, this non-actionable category disappeared because it was not renewed. So the question that this group started from is to say, did that matter? And does a new set of non-actionable subsidies need to be introduced back into the agreement? If we're thinking about how does trade law need to adapt both to address positive subsidies that the world may want, as well for industrial policy flexibility, and particularly in light of the challenges of climate change. And I think there are really two ways you could look at this, right? One way of looking at it is to say, well, what's happened since 1999? Did we all of a sudden see an explosion of cases, litigation, countries bring lawsuits against other lawsuits about these three types of categories of subsidies? The answer is no. Right. In order, and the reason why not is, well, in order to bring a lawsuit, first, it's expensive, you have to have capacity and so on and so forth. But even if you have the resources, you have to demonstrate that there was an adverse effect on trade. And moreover, for least developed countries and a couple of other developing countries, there is Article 27 of the ASEAN agreement, which continues to provide greater policy flexibility, provided certain conditions are met, which I won't go into great detail. So one way to look at this is to say, well, we took this green light subsidies category away, and the sky didn't fall. So do we really need to put this pillar back in? Now, you can make an argument the other way, which is to say, well, having taken this away, we don't know what the chilling effects were. Right? We don't know what governments didn't put in place certain subsidies because they were afraid that they might have brought lawsuits. Or you could say, well, having some guaranteed certainty would be helpful. Having some guaranteed certainty that this is a safe category would be helpful. And so the group, I think, examined these types of different questions, and I do toss this out as an initial question for all of us to consider, which is to say, is there a need for more law? Right. But if there is a need, the E15 group touched on five particular categories where we may want to reintroduce this. And let me quickly touch on those. One is for R&D subsidies, particularly R&D areas where there may be some externalities, but private sectors won't invest in those, and you may need governments to provide some form of startup capital. This may be because of capital shortages, this may be because of spillover effects, whatever the case may be. So R&D was one. The second was with respect to regional development. Now, remember, the original green box did have this category, but the group's feeling was this is a category which could be abused to say you're funneling subsidies to this particular region, for so on and so forth. So the group suggestion is that there should be some more objective metrics that are set forth in order to define what types of regions will qualify for this or what forms of development will qualify for this, rather than just having a sort of empty category. A third category was with respect to green subsidies. And the original language concerns environmental adaptation. And we felt as though, in light of all of the types of subsidies, particularly for renewable energies, green industrial policies and the like, that's too narrow of a category. And I'll touch on that in a second. But I want to go through the five categories first before I focus a little bit more on green subsidies. And then two other categories that were discussed. One is in terms of natural disasters, particularly earthquakes, flooding, and so on and so forth, subsidies that might be required in order to restore industry, but also for development and so forth in light of those. And then a fifth category that was raised with respect to man-made disasters. So this would be war-torn regions that are recovering afterwards and so on and so forth. So we added these two additional categories on top of the original three, albeit with some tweaks to two of those original three. And that's, I think, where the group came out on that. Now, in terms of whether this is a good thing or not, right, because as I started this whole conversation out, you ask yourself a question, did this change in law actually matter? Do we need to introduce more law? Well, what are the dangers of running one way or the other? Well, the danger of not having a complete safe harbor or carve out is that there could possibly be suboptimal provision of subsidies in certain categories. There could be too little, right? But this is a little bit like that Goldilocks story, right? So there could be too little, but if you write a carve out that's too broad based, there could be too much, right? So this depends a little bit on your preference of, do you prefer that there's too little, or do you prefer that there's too much that would fall into the safe harbor? Or put differently, right, the difference between a type 1 error or a type 2 error, right? But the challenge of, right, getting this just right and having lawyers write this out in a certain way is quite difficult. So that was one debate. The second debate, which factored into this, and this draws on some of the theoretical underpinnings of the industrial policy group, is it's shown that subsidies by itself it doesn't always work. In other words, in instances where this has led to positive externalities and the actual growth of certain industries and so forth, certain other preconditions need to be in place. In type of enabling infrastructure, including absorptive capacity, as well as the physical and in this day and age, sometimes digital connections to enable something to get to the marketplace. And here I'm drawing on the work particularly of Justin Lin, who was one of the co-conveners for this group, right, in terms of talking about preconditions. So then the question, second question that comes into play is, do preconditions need to be introduced in the law in order to sort of scale this back? And there are the traditional questions about dual use and so on and so forth. So these were some of the debates that surfaced within the group. And the group's goal was really to sort of flesh this out to say, if you want this type of category to come back in, what would this look like and what do we think should happen? But I wanted to point out these types of debates which occurred. Now I want to take the last couple of minutes just to quickly touch a little bit more deeply on green subsidies for the renewable energy sector. And as we know from the news from Paris and so forth, this is a major challenge. This is going to require major funding. It's going to require major technological adaptation, right? Paris was just the first step. That means that the existing language, just bring back what had expired about environmental adaptation, that's not going to be anywhere close to sufficient. The question then becomes, well, what do you put in its place? Now, you could tie it. Some suggestion was you could tie this to some of the other external requirements, particularly now at the time the E15 group met, it wasn't clear what was going to come out of Paris, but now that there is something that comes out of Paris, you could certainly tie into that. You could try to carve out particular categories in addition to this. And some of the ones which were discussed were subsidies for infrastructure development, infrastructure upgrading for renewable energy. So this is with respect to the grid itself or to battery storage and the like. For feed-in tariffs, all right, to provide additional certainty for return on investment to investors, because these are large fixed tariff costs. But the emphasis here is it should not have local content requirements. A third is on grants, rebates, so forth, for certain forms of renewable energy for consumers to encourage encourage adoption, particularly where cost is not being driven down fast enough to have the market encourage this on its own. A fourth, particularly for developing countries, is subsidies to encourage the development of off-grid renewables. So where the grid itself is not being developed fast enough, encouraging products which would allow to tap into renewables that don't rely on having then to plug into the grid. So those were some of the ideas that came forth from all this. But like I say, right, this all still stems from the first question of, is more law necessary, or can we live with uncertainty in terms of the law, and then what's getting crowded out here versus if we are to introduce law back in, how much are we going to introduce an error of, right, just too much, just too little? How do we get this so it's just right? But getting it just right is quite difficult as a task. So the question is really, which way do you prefer to err on all of this?
Thank you, Mark. So we now have Gary Horlick, attorney, law offices of Gary and Horlick. He was the moving force behind the subsidies E15 group, and of course, many other initiatives which we have benefited from him. He'll address questions which are, what areas need to be disciplined further to prevent negative spillovers? Could a case be made to strengthen subsidies disciplines, e.g. in areas such as investment incentives, local content requirements, trade remedies, or resource depleting subsidies? Gary, you have the floor.
Thanks very much. As Bernard and Mark have laid out, subsidies are one of many policy instruments governments use, and they have to be looked at in that context. The one thing worth noting, they generate a lot of fraud and corruption, which is always something to worry about with subsidy programs, but so do other policy instruments. So the question, the initial question framed is, it's a policy instrument. That's not good or bad within a country, within a government space, until it starts affecting people and enterprises outside that space. The methodology for determining whether it's affecting people outside that space in the current WTO agreements is primitive, to be polite, and essentially is based on injury determinations in anti-dumping cases, which makes no particular sense because subsidies are different than dumping. I'm not saying better or worse, just different. So the remit of the group of the subsidies group was to ignore existing law and start over, blank sheet of paper. And both Bernard and Mark were extremely helpful in that exercise, as were many other people. But so start with its policy space, and whether you do something about it, you start with, does it affect anyone? If it's only within that government's policy space, well, that's their problem. Some of the things in current law are historical. The agreement was drafted essentially almost entirely by the U.S., EU, and Canada, so there was some, and particularly by countervailing duty authorities. So this is a classic, if you give someone with a hammer, you know, a problem, they'll nail it, they'll hit it. You know, people use the tools they're used to. So this is not an optimal subsidies agreement, so we were tasked to look at, if you started from scratch, what would you do? Once you start doing that, you quickly run into the sort of basic purpose of the current agreement, which is to deal with impacts on competitors. And there's nothing wrong with that. Subsidies can, not necessarily, but they certainly can impact on competitors. In this case, competitors outside the in another WTO member. So already there's a distortion within the country not being dealt with. The U.S., which is the country I know best, has given huge subsidies, huge subsidies in many industries to shift to build new plants in non-union states. That obviously is not good news for existing plants in union states. And it's not the federal government doing it, it's state governments. There's no discipline at all. So we're talking huge sums, $500 million to Hyundai to build cars, some unimaginable amount. I've never gotten a good quantification, so the best I heard was $1 billion to ThyssenKrupp to build a plant that didn't work anyhow, et cetera, et cetera. But these are big bucks, and they affect competitors within the country, and the WTO rules, understandably, do nothing about that, unless they affect competitors outside. So they affect competitors. I'll leave out the competition policy issue of, do they affect competition, which is something we didn't explore, and go to the meat of the issue today. Nothing in the WTO agreement except a very tiny piece of Article 8 had anything to do with the effect of subsidies outside of its effect on competitors, in particular global goods. And so that is the Article 8 had, as Mark laid out, issued items on R&D, but extremely narrowly drafted, essentially drafted to fit existing EU and U.S. programs in 1992. Regional development was Canadian and EU regional programs at the time, and then Mexico at the last minute insisted on an environmental one and was asked for a proposal, so it X'd out half of a six-year-old EU proposal, leaving a very minor thing for adaptation. So I would answer Mark's question. We don't know what the effect of a carve-out for non-actionable subsidies would be, because what they carved out was so trivial no one cared. But nothing there was about the externalities of subsidies that do things to the global commons. And this shows up most obviously with fish, and it's always worth raising, but so I could well subsidize my fisher people, you could subsidize your fisher people. No fish are moving across the border to harm a competitor, but guess what? All the fish disappear, which is what's happening. Subsidies are quite important in the fishing business because it accelerated, in particular, larger boats that could go further out, longer, and much more important, electronics. You could find the fish. And before, the only thing that kept fish alive was you couldn't find them. Once you could find them, you could destroy the entire stock, which is what the human race is busy trying to do. And a lot of that involved subsidies. Subsidies are not the only problem, but it'd be a start. So that's why fishing subsidies are being discussed with luck as we speak. That immediately leads you to climate change, or dare I call it global warming. And I get this from friends of mine in large chemical and mining companies and clients. So they think there's such a thing and it's man-made, so don't blame me. The huge amounts of money are spent subsidizing the production and consumption of fossil fuels. Huge, unimaginably large sums. Estimates run up to $500 billion a year. And you have to separate that out. So it's not realistic to say we're going to eliminate subsidies for consumption of fossil fuels to poor people. You have to do something about poverty before you do that. But an obvious start, which was my personal conclusion, I carefully don't speak for the group on this, is elimination of subsidies for production of fossil fuels and consumption in developed countries, more or less, although you can argue about that. So that's a start. And to me, in light of the agreement in Paris, it's one of many, but one of many necessary steps. You're not going to get to 1.5 unless you substantially eliminate the incentive to use fossil fuels. And quite obviously, the economic attractiveness of the renewable energy that Mark was talking about is a lot less if fossil fuels are subsidized. So these are two crossing lines. So if you don't get the cost of using green energy below fossil fuels by one means or another, people aren't going to do it. So that's the first two, is fishery subsidies and fossil fuels. Then you, and those are the two that I wanted to talk about.
I'd like to talk about investment incentives.
I'm getting to those. So after that, they're equally bad but less pressing. Investment incentives, by now, companies have learned how to manipulate governments. So what happens, and I've done this for clients, is you figure out where you want to put your plant, and then certainly in the U.S., you start a competition among at least two or maybe three states to jack up the subsidies you get. That's pure economic waste. It's good for the corporate balance sheet, but it's not a good way to do things. There's a long list after that, which is in our paper. But I want to finish up. The key ones, as I said, would be fisheries and fossil fuel, because those are imminent dangers. There are a number of fish stocks, which are already pretty much gone, but on the verge, and fossil fuels, if Paris didn't remind you, it wasn't enough. We've had years of knowing this. So let me focus on those two. But in there's a whole range of subsidies that go to industry that industry has learned to manipulate. Locational is merely one example. When you really get businesses there, businesses don't like other companies' subsidies, but they're reluctant to get rid of their own.
Thank you, Gary. In fact, it's interesting what Gary talked about in the context of investment incentives, that companies have learned to manipulate countries. And one of the policy options from the investment group is actually to set up a center to help less developed countries in negotiating these contracts and have models which would help in that. It's along the lines of the center which is in Geneva to help developing countries with their WTO cases, the ACWL. So something along those lines for investment agreement also, among the various options which are there. So now, Professor Bhattacharya is not here. For a little while after Anne's points, I will assume my presence as being that of Mr. Bhattacharya. So, but I'll come to Mr. Bhattacharya last. First, we have Anne Escobedo, Director of International Government Affairs, ArcelorMittal, who comes to us with a very sharp perception of both of the practical aspects in the industry plus an intellectual evaluation of how the policies interact with that practical aspect. So the floor is yours.
Thank you. Can you hear me? I guess the introduction of how companies manipulate government was a bit of a tough introduction, I would say. We do not manipulate government. We negotiate with them. So I hope our lawyers are not presenting our industry like that. But anyway, for future reference. I think, just for you, for some background, ArcelorMittal is a steel and mining producer. The steel sector and the mining sector are managed worldwide pretty much as reference for jobs. Different countries have built their economy, one of the biggest steel producers in the world, built their economy about the pillar of steel. The mining sector is also reference to community engagement. And it's also linked to development of that community and development of that economy, which puts the industry in both mining and maybe more the steel side very sensitive in terms of the discrepancy on use of steel. At this point, I'll make some reference to what was done on the definitions of steel, and I might just highlight to a case that for me it's quite funny because we are talking about two developed countries, one saying that the other is doing unfair subsidy. I'm talking about the US launching an anti-subsidy case against the EU when the EU is supposed to comply with WTO. So for me these are typical examples of misunderstanding or misinterpretation of what the WTO subsidy agreement is about. But going more in terms of the elements that were discussed between subsidy or investment promotion, I guess if we look for the extractive sector, it is indeed important to understand that there is a bit of a carrot and stick approach. We see more and more governments engaging on they want just more added value out from the investment they receive. They have learned about the impact this investment can do to the parallel economy running in sidelines of the project. So we're also seeing communities learning about these. So the asks about from the communities are increasing. An example, a clear example, and it's a tool on the regulatory approach, is local content, with Harsha refers to. When governments negotiate local content, and some governments are more strict about it, some are more transitional, there's always the approach of saying, okay, you invest in infrastructure, that normally is about 60% of the value of our greenfield project on mining. But then we need to figure out how are we going to develop the structure for adding additional value to the overall context of the project. In exchange of that, okay, companies at the end of the day, we have shareholders. The shareholders are always looking at what is the added value we're going to get out of any penny we invest. So we do need to put on the table saying, okay, we are going to present this project development, but then how can we coordinate with the government to share the responsibility? And this is a bit on basically the concepts that sometimes we're talking about subsidy on development. The elements that we play on local content is how do we emphasize, or that we as a company, we also work with governments on how to emphasize the policies that require that this investment that we do also promotes the efficiency and the capacity, let's assume supply chain for instance. Let's talk a country in Africa that this issue of supply chain has become a very frequent ask. How to develop your supply chain so all is local provided? If a company agrees in source from the local government, the local government needs to take a responsibility that by us generating this artificial demand, they will also help to become, that in this new industry becomes capable. So this is what we call, a parallel impact on the stick that the government put on us, but they need also to ensure this development. Maybe on a second point approach, which was mentioned by some of other panelists, is the climate change issue, which right now is a lot being interlinked with the discussion on the WTO. And here I want to make a direct line with some of the discussions that have been happening in policy coherence. And I think for subsidy policies, the new ones as suggested or the existing ones, there has to be an understanding on how a definition of subsidy generates possibly good impact on some competitions or some development of competition or domestic production, but also has imperative effect on parallel policies. Let's just make some examples. We talk about green goods now, and it is very heavily discussed right now which products to include and the benefit this will create to all around the world. What happened with the products included on that list? Normally, they will go into any country without any market distortion or market tariffs. So, what happens with the domestic production of that product in that country, which initially was helped by these import tariffs? Are we going to decide, okay, is that product going to need to be more competitive, or the government is going to help make quicker the transition for that producer to be able to compete with the new imports of that? If not, then okay, let's assume then, do we stop production of that product all the way around and we just produce it in the country that can produce it cheap? That is a question that we are going to confront with climate change. What are we going to do? Are we going to be ready for all products linked to climate change to be produced in the cheapest or in the countries that have the most subsidy structure? And this is a question that for me is quite important to link between the elements of subsidies, the elements of policy coherence, and the elements of development. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Anna. Initially, Bernard had said that there's a heavy dosage of subsidies at the podium. I was hoping to get something on industrial policy from Deb Bhattacharya, but let me just share with you very quickly some of the key insights from the work on new industrial policies. You won't be surprised if I say that different levels of income, countries with different levels of income actually need different kinds of industrial policies. But it's interesting to note that the rich countries and the middle income countries actually have a lot of overlap in terms of technology intensive and knowledge intensive policies. But knowledge augmentation is important across the board. It's the infrastructure, it's the collaboration between government and industry, it's institutions which are very different in terms of what is established and what needs to be established that make a large difference, plus the capacity of the policymaker and the country itself to handle certain kind of policies. So The second thing is, in a world of global value chains, restrictive policies, whether they are at the border or inside the border, are not really good support policies. In fact, if you are looking at support policies, then trade policies inside the border are very important. And by trade policies, I mean the coverage in standards areas and trade facilitation kind of policies. There is now a major overlap between trade and investment, and the experience suggests that it's not as much as trade support industrial policy which gives large effect, but it's the investment support policies that give large impact. And therefore, that leads into trade augmentation also. So the kind of points which were being talked about. On WTO, the rules which actually need to be re-looked at, we felt two particular areas. One was green subsidies, where there is a global reason. It could also be knowledge subsidies, etc., for intervention. We have heard a lot about that. Another one was local content requirements. Now, local content requirements in certain parts like subsidy services, etc., there are no disciplines. So there are areas where more discipline is needed, but also the prohibition which is there. One idea was that instead of a prohibition, since so many are actually using it, and this goes back to the Uruguay round where safeguards and voluntary export restraints were traded off, perhaps we could still have disciplines on local content requirements, but one could consider changing prohibition into adverse effect, which is the normal kind of impact which is there. Then the most important policies actually are knowledge enhancing policies, infrastructure skill shortcomings being addressed, system oriented policies, which have a wide scale impact, and soft rather than hard policies. So basically, instead of tariffs, looking at where is the shortcoming, and you address that shortcoming directly. And really important is collaboration and communication between policymakers and business, and of course, across countries, across regions, and international efforts become important. And given the fact that we have mega regionals coming in, we have to recognize that opportunities are actually being reduced for a lot of less developed countries. So how to find ways of making them more participative in the market system which is emerging. So these are some of the things on industrial policy. I open the floor now to questions, and we will then take any other additional points from the speakers also when they are responding. The floor is open for questions.
Okay, I think I want to respond to the comment from Mark on subsidy for developing countries. Well, when you talk of the disadvantaged regions, I believe that developing countries is part of it. And I would want to say that based on our economic status and based on the fact that WTO would wish to see a balanced level of industrialization, I wish to think that it is important that we continue on subsidy for developing country and poor country. And as much as we have issues of corruption and the like, we need to think of measures that can be able to respond to that. For example, subsidies accompanied by maybe monitoring processes like much involvement of the community, much awareness program of their such funding, and that may be when the communities and the people are more aware of programs that are based on that, then they are able to monitor it even more. At the same time, maybe I'd also want to think that subsidy should also include both funds and in terms of kind, whereby we could have equipments and machineries accompanying that. For local content, I actually come from the media background. I'm the chairperson for Kenya Women Media Owners Association, and we're also struggling to meet the requirement of 60% local content, so it's actually an issue.
Thank you.
gentleman.
My first question is to Gary. You were mentioning about disciplining fossil fuel subsidies. My question is, do you think the WTO is the best forum to deal with fossil fuel subsidies? And what are the challenges you foresee in, you know, disciplining fossil fuel subsidies from a practical perspective under WTO or any other forum? And the second question is more broadly to the subsidies panel. You know, I would like to know whether Mark, for instance, you mentioned about subsidies related to, green subsidies and all. There is this issue of subsidy elements that might be there when you were talking about cap and trade system and free allocation of emission allowances, which might be there. So did you get a chance to look at that issue? Another related, not exactly on subsidy maybe, but I would like to hear from the esteemed panel your view on, you know, there is, I'm part of the Mini 15 group on trade and climate change, and one issue we were dealing with there is about climate clubs, and for instance, a club of climate club, which is focusing on international emission trading, a linkage of different emission trading schemes. So one issue which was raised there is whether when we're talking about trading in emission reduction units, whether those would be covered under WTO law. Are they goods or are they services, or, you know, those issues are being debated. So I'd like to hear from you your views on that. Thank you.
Thank you. Very interesting presentation. My name is Yaonsu from the Africa Center for Economic Transformation. I think my perception that generally the discussion on subsidies in the WTO has really proceeded on the basically on the basis of competition between developed country firms and countries, and also. And then there's some acknowledgement made for global public goods. But I think the role of subsidies in development has been considerably underplayed. And if you look at the developmental impact of subsidies, then in a sense you can't, subsidies are just one element of a good industrial policy package. You cannot distinguish the two. And it's also a historical fact that just about any country that has developed as a latecomer has used subsidies as part of the instruments of really breaking into the global market. I mean, the role of export promotion in East Asia and before that even Europe is clear. But all of that seemed to have been swept aside during the WTO discussion, which has really made it very constrained the ability of developing. For instance, when they had these three upsets in Article 8, R&D and regional development, right? Acquiring technology and mastering technology for developed country firms is the equivalent of R&D. And to really acknowledge that for developed country firms and not to acknowledge it for developing country firms, I think is something that needs to be looked at. And similarly, as my predecessor said, the regional, if developed countries can make special programs from their lagging regions, how much more so from the global level making special programs for poor countries? And lastly, I also think that the local content for many developing countries, particularly for African countries, what we have to bring to the table, in addition to many people that are unemployed, it's our natural resources. And to really have prohibitions that disallow us from really using it as a way to provide employment and businesses for our people really tie our hands in terms of development. And I think these are all needs to be looked at if we really see WTO is really serious about development.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Hi, I'm Sally from the IGC in Rwanda. I see a lot of developing countries use tax exemptions as an alternative to subsidies. Can you say a little bit about the how that compares in terms of advantages and disadvantages to just giving outright subsidies.
A little louder.
A little louder. How tax exemptions as an alternative industrial policy to giving out subsidies compares in terms of pros and cons. And my other question was to Bernard. Do you have any good examples from developing countries of policies that target those missing links in supply chains that maybe you could illustrate why that's a good policy and how it avoids being too distortive and risking corruption and the other concerns?
One here. Right at the end. First.
I'm Benson Kathuri from East Africa Trade Review. Can incentives given by governments to manufacturers in special economic processing zones be considered as subsidies?
We'll take
another round. I'm Antipas from Innovation Kenya. My question is regarding I have a feeling that subsidies are more of intervention, and is it really sustainable? Or because what usually happens when you exit or you move that subsidy, will the enterprises or the company that are being helped, will they continue doing business? So I have a feeling is there a way that probably you can think about sustainability when you exit or remove that subsidy for an enterprise or the country remove that subsidy for that.
Thank you. Is the last question clear to you?
Part of it. Let me start. So incentives within special economic zones could well be subsidies under WTO rules. For certain developing countries have a waiver an extended phase out under Article 27 of the subsidies agreement. That's only for previously existing programs. So in general, yes, it's a subsidy, could well be an export subsidy, which is prohibited, but for certain developing countries, including possibly Kenya, they may be allowed. But you'd have to look at the details of the program and whether anything changed, and whether Kenya was part of the extension, which was granted last year. So that's at least the first part. I don't know if that answers your whole question. Let me keep going through some of the other questions. The WTO, yes, could be a vehicle for banning fossil fuel subsidies. Mechanically, it's quite easy. You just amend the subsidies agreement and add it to Article 3. You need a consensus, and so some country would say, I won't do that unless you agree to something totally unrelated. That's what's dragging the WTO down. Then who would enforce it? There's no enforcement by WTO. Enforcement is by members. There have only been three, maybe four, depending on how you count it, cases brought against subsidies out of the, not the prohibited export subsidies, but normal subsidies out of 501 cases. Countries don't like attacking other countries' subsidies because they all live in glass houses. And they all think of themselves as defendants. Finally, if some country did actually bring one, the WTO has a huge compliance problem, which is even worse on subsidies, because it doesn't go back and capture them. So the short answer is no, it'd be wildly impractical, which means environment ministers meeting somewhere on their own will ban them, and it won't fit WTO rules particularly well. But that's because the WTO hasn't taken this up. Finally, are emission certificates a subsidy? Potentially. So you have this question about emission taxes versus emission certificates. Businesses don't like new taxes, at least in the U.S. They don't like taxes, understandably. I don't either. And the country was founded on not paying taxes. So the cap and trade concept was originally used for acid rain was to give people permits which are auctionable, et cetera. The last time the U.S. considered this, which was 2010, was it 9 or 10, turned into a huge fight about the certificates, the administration proposing that 85% be auctioned, and an industry coalition proposing successfully that 15% be auctioned. Plus, there were some free ones for agriculture. The bill only got through our House of Representatives, and the day before the vote, they'd given away 102% of the certificates, which is hard to do. So it turns into a squabble of who gets the money. In the EU, and I don't remember the details well enough, they actually gave away windfalls to several industries in round one, I think it was. And the electrical generating industry made off with piles of money and didn't lower the rates. So this is what happens. Once you get into subsidies, you get into a lot of game playing. So I wouldn't recommend it. Bottom line, if they're not specific, they're not a subsidy. And if they are specific, they are. So the wider you spread them, the less likely they are, the certificates are a subsidy. That would only be for production of goods. If they're given to service providers, they're not a subsidy because there's no discipline on subsidies to service providers. And I think those are my questions.
Mark, would you like to? So I'll quickly address the first question, which is about subsidies for developing countries. So here, let me clarify a little bit. Developing countries, or at least those in the annex, through Article 27 already today have special and differential treatment in terms of the types of subsidies they're allowed to provide compared to everyone else who falls outside that annex. So that's something which already exists today that doesn't require any change in law or anything of that. There are ways you could carve this out, which it could be very beneficial for helping that region catch up, and we can each name a region from whatever country we come from, right, that would fit that. And there are ways that this could be essentially a rent-seeking exercise by certain industries with certain well-connected groups and so on and so forth in those areas that basically is economically inefficient. So how do we design or write those rules to have more of the former and less of the latter? Right, and the feeling was, well, the rules as they were written back in 1984 don't quite do that. And probably more detailed metrics-based rules need to be put into place on that. Gary, did you want to
add one more thought? So what you have right now is some developing countries are allowed to give export subsidies, which basically are for export promotion zones. So special economic zones are set up, and you get a subsidy to export. If you think, so let's say there are 15 such countries. What you're doing is you're setting up a system where 15 countries, all of them poor, can compete to subsidize developed country consumers. Ain't it great?
So on the question about emission schemes, right? Certainly, as Gary's already alluded to, there's a way in which you could design an emission certificate or some form of emission scheme whereby under the legal definition under WTO law, this would be a subsidy. Or it could not be, right? I mean, if you designed it a certain way so that it was provided equally to all parties regardless of sector and so on and so forth, it could not be. I think our group did not dive into deeply on those because this is a matter of design. And I think it will be an iterative process of how do you do this. But there are systemic issues here, right? Do you put something into the law and then ask countries to then fit their scheme within that? Do you not put anything into the law and think, well, now nobody's going to challenge this because this is going to look so horrible that you're going after a country for what's essentially a green growth subsidy? Or do you have them come to seek a waiver from the WTO or seek clarification through the SCM committee? So there are various systemic designs. So we focused on the systemic design, but we didn't dive into the detail on the specific design of the emission scheme because, in our view, it's a little too early, right, depending on how those are going to get carved out.
Let me add one more brief thought. No developing country subsidy has been challenged in 20 years. So go ahead and do what you want. The one exception was a very complex scheme to give the president of Indonesia's son a market for his cars, and subsidies was a tiny piece of it. So basically do what you want. No one's going to challenge you. And if you only look a little further south, there's proof of it.
Okay, so some of these questions have already been addressed. I think basically there's a disconnect between what we have in the WTO and how an economist would design disciplines, right? Because economists would focus on what are the welfare effects, what are the efficiency, are we actually choosing the most efficient instruments to deal with particular market failures, are we controlling capture, the political economy dimension. So it's what we have in the WTO is a bit much more simpler, which is to say, okay, we have disciplines, and essentially it all boils down to, is what I'm doing affecting you negatively enough that you have an incentive to take action against me? Right? And as Gary said, at the end of the day, nobody's really taken action against any developing countries, partly because, you know, there is a political dimension to this, partly because there isn't enough of an incentive to do it. Now, that doesn't mean it's not going to happen, that doesn't mean it can't happen, but on average, you know, it's not that, in that sense, the constraint is not all that binding. I think what is much more important is there isn't any effort at all in the WTO to try and steer intervention towards efficient ways of intervening. So take the local content example that was mentioned. Right now, is that the most efficient way of supporting domestic production of those particular goods and services? I think that's the question to ask, and that might not be the case at all. But the WTO doesn't really help you kind of go through a domestic process to say, okay, this is our objective, how do we do that most efficiently? And it also doesn't help you answer the question, is it having the effect we want to have? Right? So these are all things where I think the system kind of could be designed in a much more effective way. Now, the other point I want to make is on the definition of subsidies, right? So we got, you know, the question was, are tax exemptions a subsidy, export processing zones, what goes on there, is that a subsidy? And this is all kind of arbitrary, right? Because again, from an economic point of view, anything a government does to support a particular activity or a particular industry is going to implicitly be taxing the rest of the economy. So in that sense, it is kind of an artificial construct, which is very much driven by a focus on, is there money being spent? But there's lots of substitutes where no money is actually being spent, but we are effectively supporting a particular activity. So in that sense, it's piecemeal, right? So I think that, again, almost by definition, what is being done in the WTO is an exercise in the second best. Specific examples of missing links in supply chains. And again, here I would say it's very much again a function of this, how do we define it? So quite frequently what a government might do or a local authority might do in terms of saying, okay, we're going to help you build the cold chain. Right? And part of what we're going to be doing is actually dealing with local constraints which prevent you from actually making that investment. Now, in a sense, that's a subsidy. Right? Because you're only doing it for that particular firm, that particular industry, you're not doing it for others, but nonetheless, you know, assuming that that actually deals with a coordination failure, it makes economic sense to do it. Green channels in customs could be the same thing. So we're going to really specify a particular type of product that can move through quickly. We're not going to do that for others. Effectively, you're taxing the others. You're giving a subsidy to those guys. So I think there are examples which we can talk about in terms of particular interventions, but I really want to emphasize this point that this is a much bigger issue which is not really being addressed through the disciplines we have now. One thing I wanted to say in my initial remarks, which I forgot to do, or at least I did it kind of vaguely, I think one of the things we need to do much more in terms of collecting data in this particular area, and also kind of with a view of recognizing the fact that there are different ways of achieving and supporting a particular activity which would be captured under the industrial policy heading, where essentially there is very little transparency, or not anywhere near enough transparency, in this particular arena.
If I could just add one thing. The data is pathetic. The OECD, despite heroic attempts to get member governments to report, can't get really comprehensive. GTA, which Bernard used, is the best of a bad lot, so there's a real need for it. Having said that, and I hope he doesn't have a heart attack, on the fisheries question and the fossil fuels, I would not wait for more data.
I agree.
Yeah, there's plenty of data on those.
Anna.
Maybe just on 2 points that have already been touched. Regarding the tax and sanction and whether they are subsidy and the practices, on my experience, tax exemptions are more linked on individual cases, like you have a green project, a greenfield project that you're starting, then you have tax exemption for 10 years, so the development goes. That's kind of a normal practice worldwide, that you do have certain type of tax review on specific areas. Regarding on the appreciation on whether there are subsidies or not, well, I let the legal frame to define that. But the impact that creates is linked to the investment side. Mm-hmm. And that also is something that I would like to link to the missing links on the supply chain, is what does it mean to have the investment on a country or to promote the imports to fill the supply chain of that country. And that's an element that I don't think there is a logic view, nor on the national regulations and nor on the WTO. And I just have a question for the legal panelists. We are seeing very hard competition law regulated in developed countries. And then on developed countries, we are seeing very free trade spirit. How does that work? How can you very demanding with your local producers and then very free willing with your importers? And I'm going to stop there. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Very quickly, I'll address a few points which were not addressed. One on grants also being subsidies. Actually, if you go to WTO provisions, subsidies are what the governments of the specific member country are providing. So it's an international grant per se would not come within that context. Similarly, on tax exemption, Anna said that the legal aspect is important. Actually, the definition of subsidies in the Subsidies and Countervailing Measures Agreement includes situations where you don't have general tax exemptions. General tax exemption would be something like your income tax rate being lowered. That's not a subsidy. But if for a particular industry, you have a lower indirect tax, suppose you have a general indirect tax in the economy, a lower one than that somebody could argue is a subsidy. And fiscal incentives definitely are. On R&D subsidies, which you talked about, or the point that why for developed countries, not for developing countries. Actually, there is nothing which developed countries can do which developing countries under the provisions of WTO especially cannot do. In fact, if anything, developing countries can do more. And so if the structure of subsidies is that there are certain subsidies which are prohibited. So you have export subsidies prohibited, because the idea is, the framework of thought is, we have to make sure that there is not an adverse effect on other members' ability to trade, so the level playing field is not disturbed. And in export subsidy, the underlying notion is, obviously you are disturbing the level playing field of exports, so you should not do that. But even there, developing countries, as was pointed out in Annex 7, which is all LDCs and all developing countries with per capita income less than $1,000 are exempted. They can actually give something which is otherwise prohibited. On LCR, that was another point which was raised, that many people are unemployed. Actually, LCR is normally prohibited in general, but there are loopholes in government procurement or through services. But the point to keep in mind, and this links up with the monitoring aspect which was talked about, that the disciplines and the system of the structure or the framework of how the processes have to be conducted in member countries under WTO, basically aims at good governance, or at transparency, at informing people so that they can question if there is some concern. So similarly, LCR, the fact that you have many people unemployed doesn't mean that LCR is the right answer, because we are in a world where we have to compete. So how do we have the policy combinations which actually increases our competitiveness if there is an LCR which you want to use and it's prohibited? Somebody may not bring a case against you. That's a different issue. But is that the best way of ensuring competitiveness, and which is both in quality and cost context? So what these rules make you do is to think about what is an appropriate policy structure. Bernard said that they don't go far enough, yes, but they do take you in that direction. Similarly, on export processing zones, what we have to remember is that, also for subsidies, for example, it's not important where the subsidy is provided within a country, but the manner of subsidy which is provided. So it may be provided in the export processing zone or elsewhere, but if that subsidy creates a problem under the WTO rules, the provision would be then inconsistent with them. There was one question raised. I just leave the lawyers to address it. I could have addressed it, but then I'm not a lawyer.
Remember the question?
Which question?
By Anna.
Yeah, why competition law is more... really addressed by regulators when trade law is more seen as a free tariff and more and stronger on subsidies. Why this disparity on policy?
In the EU, competition law regulates subsidies. In the US, I don't think anyone thought about it in 1787, or they would have. So we have a very complicated and incoherent jurisprudence in the U.S. about subsidies, which in practice doesn't restrain, as you know, state sub-central subsidies. To summarize, the only place in the world outside WTO where there are real rules on discipline on subsidies is the EU. Query how effective they are. They may wind up just approving them, but at least there's a process. The U.S., there are probably constitutional limits on how far the federal government can limit what states do, but practically states are competing with each other. It's a complete zero-sum game. There's a hotel chain headquartered in Washington, D.C. So 20 years ago, and it eventually set up its headquarters in suburban Maryland, 20 years ago it announced it was going to move to either D.C., Virginia, or Maryland, and who would offer the most, which turned out to be $55 million from Maryland to stay exactly where it was, which is bad enough. And so a new CEO took over this year and said he was thinking of doing the same thing.
That's a private industrial policy. We talked about a lot which is not known, but we also talked about good policies. And one of the things which we learned here is that it's actually not that good policies are not known in every instance. So they were identified, for example, by Gary and others. But at the same time, we need to keep in mind the positive externalities and negative externalities, system-oriented or very specific interventions which lead to lack of competitiveness. If we have that lens, then I think which way to go with subsidies would be even clearer before we have full information. So I thank you all, and I wish you all the best for the late afternoon. Thank you.